Hi, I'm Vairahi. I'm so excited because today I get to tell you all about the magic number of computing, 256. What makes 256 such a unique number? Well, in order to answer that question, we first need to do a quick recap of something called binary, which you might remember from one of my previous episodes. Binary, which is also just the base 2 number system, is made up of zeros and ones. Binary involves bits and bytes. In order to represent a single character, you usually need about 1 byte of information. 1 byte is also equivalent to 8 consecutive bits. There must be a more compact, human-friendly version of representing a single character, something better than these zeros and ones right here. Well, it turns out there is, and that's where encoding schemes come in. An encoding scheme is a way of translating between a more human-friendly representation of something and the machine-friendly version of something. We can think of encoding schemes as the Rosetta Stone of converting and translating between different number systems. And the encoding schemes that we're going to talk about today have to do with translating between a human-friendly representation of a character and the binary representation of that same character. One kind of encoding scheme that you might run into is the Ascii encoding scheme. The Ascii encoding scheme converts between 128 different possibilities. It converts between uppercase and lowercase characters, the digits 0 through 9, punctuation, tabs, spaces, and a couple other fun things too. We can see that we're converting between 2 different number systems, and we can see the equivalent that we're translating between. So for example, in the decimal number system, the number 65 can be converted into hexadecimals, which is the equivalent of this character, capital letter A. Let's see an actual example of what it means to use the ASCII encoding table in order to convert between binary and another number system. Down here in green, we see my name represented in the full form binary version. We'll see that the letter, the capital letter V, is represented with 01010110. And the same goes for the rest of the letters in my name as well. Again, that's kind of a mouthful. So let's see if we can represent this in a better way. Well, we can convert these binary representations of my name into another format, base 10. Taking a look at the capital letter V, if we look at the ASCII encoding table, we'll see that we can also represent the capital letter V as the number 86. And for the lowercase letter A, we can represent that as 97. The same goes for the rest of these letters here. Notice that we can translate my name into the base 10 representation. And if we were to convert from the base 10 representation of the capital letter V, which is 86 here, we would get the same binary representation of that same character. Let's take a look at just one of these bytes of information. Notice here that there is a trailing zero digit that we're starting the byte of information with. It's a zero bit. And if we take a look at the rest of these, there's a trailing zero bit of information in all of these binary representations. Remember that binary has 8 possible numbers that you can fill in a single byte. But in our representation of my name, we always have an empty zero. And that feels a little wasteful because we're not really even using it. This one little zero, this one little bit of information might seem kind of inconsequential to us right now, But let's think about what that actually means. If we frame it in the context of base 2 and the powers of 2, we'll realize that this one bit of information is actually pretty powerful. And so it's really important for us to not waste it. 2 to the power of 7 gives us 128, which means that when you use just 7 bits of information, you have 128 different permutations of how you can use zeros and ones in 7 single bits. So what happens if you add another bit of information to give us 8 bits, or 1 byte? Well, 2 to the power of 8 is 256. That's a whole lot more permutations than 128. In fact, it's twice as many. And this was the realization that led to the extension of the original ASCII table. The original ASCII table had 128 different permutations because, as we've realized, it used 7 bits of information to represent all of those different characters and symbols. But the extended ASCII table leveraged that additional bit that we were wasting previously. And by leveraging that last bit, instead of 128 possibilities, the extended ASCII table gave us 256 possibilities. The extended ASCII table, which has 256 different characters and symbols and interesting things that it can represent, uses all 8 bits. The original ASCII table only represented 95 actual characters, but most languages need more than that, especially European languages, which have very many different types of characters. So for them, it made sense to try to find other ways to represent characters because they needed to actually use them. And that's where that additional bit of information and turning 128 possibilities into 256 possibilities ended up being super useful and powerful. Of course, the extended ASCII table is just one encoding scheme. And that's why it's important to note that it's unstandardized. There's lots of different types of encoding schemes out there. And this is just one example of how it can be used. The ASCII table and ASCII encoding scheme are just one example of how the number 256 is a maximization of how many different permutations exist within one single byte of information. And it goes to show you how even one bit can be so powerful and can double the number of things and number of characters that you can represent. To learn more about 256, the magical number of computing, or to stay up to date on my future episodes, sign up for an account on Dev2 and follow me at Vaidehi Joshi. Thanks for watching.
Thanks to Heroku for sponsoring BaseCS. I'm Ben, one of the founders of Dev, and I want to give a shout out to Heroku, the platform that's allowed us to scale from zero to millions of monthly visitors since we started this venture a few years ago. We rely on Heroku's managed Postgres alongside the rest of their infrastructure to ensure reliability and flexibility as we scale. If you're looking to scale a complex web app without all the chaos, please check out Heroku. Thanks a lot.